Welcome to part three of our interview with Professor Richard Wolff, and he's got an actual solution to capitalism. I think it also goes to the amazing power of the lack of power of an opposition party in America. People don't have an alternative. That's why half the country doesn't even bother to vote, because they know, hey, if they voted for Hillary Clinton, they're going to get TPP. They already got NAFTA from her. So why would they vote for her? And if they vote for Trump, well, he's going to screw them over like he's doing right now with the health care and taxes and all the other ways. So half the country doesn't vote, yet still people try to pretend the problem is people like me or Jill Stein or Susan Sarandon, and not really what the problem is, which is the system we have, which is run on 100% corporate cash. So that's, but you, what I love about you is that unlike me, who I can articulate the problem, you actually have a solution. So you have this idea of bringing democracy to the workplace. Could you talk about that?
Yes. Look, everything in our economy kind of starts in the enterprise. Think about the factory, the office, the store. The way decisions are made in these institutions shapes the goods and services we have, the prices we have to pay for them, the wages and salaries we can get. Most of those key decisions are made enterprise by enterprise. And so the real question is, how do those decisions get made in and by the enterprises? Who exactly makes the decision? For example, do we hire more workers or not? Do we raise the price of what we sell or not? Do we improve the wages of our workers or not? The question is, how are these decisions made and by whom? When you ask that question, here's the answer. You have no alternative but to find. A capitalist corporation is run by a tiny number of people. In a typical corporation, that group of people is called the board of directors. It typically has 15 to 20 people. How do you get on the board of directors to be in the position of making the decisions? Because the board of directors, let's take an example, General Motors. The board of directors decides whether they produce cars or trucks or what combination. The board of directors decides what they will charge for the cars and the trucks. They will decide how they get produced, in a way that pollutes the air and water or in another way. The board of directors will decide whether the cars are produced in the United States or in Mexico or Canada or China. The board of directors decides what to do with the profits. All the workers help to produce the profits. But a tiny group of people at the top decide what to do with them. And that's how every corporation works. Well, how do you get on the board of directors? You are elected. If your listeners and your viewers don't know, I'll tell them. Every year there's an election in a corporation. The people who are shareholders get to vote on who is on the board of directors. That's how it works. And you get one vote for each share you own. If your grandmother left you 11 shares, you get 11 votes. If you're a wealthy person who has a million shares, you get a million votes. Well, here's a little statistic you should never forget. 1% of shareholders in America own 3/4 of the shares. That's your 1%. Those are the people who decide who's on the board of directors. Okay, now what does that mean for the mass of Americans? It means when you go to work in a factory, in an office, in a store, when you cross the threshold from the street into your workplace, you're entering a place where you will be told what to do, how to do it, where to do it, when to do it. And at the end of your work time, you are told, go home, because whatever you help to produce, you have no say over. It immediately belongs to somebody else. You're done. In other words, you have no control over that job. You have no control over the decisions that affect your life, including the decision of whether or not you have a job, whether or not you have income, whether or not you can take care of your family. It's an amazing system. But here's the word that does not apply to the workplace. It is not democratic. Democratic means if you're affected by a decision, you have the right to participate in making it. That's why we elect our mayor, our congressperson, our senator, our president. They make decisions that affect us. We have to have power over them. But when we go to work, we don't ask for it. We don't get it. The decisions are made by people over whom we have no control at all. In other words, the workplace is undemocratic. And now here comes the punchline. Why is anybody surprised that if a tiny number of people are in the position to make all the decisions, that the decisions they make are good for them, but not for the rest of us? Is that a surprise? Right. Is that something that you should go, oh my goodness, I never thought of it? Everything I'm saying now, the American people know. They don't need me to tell them. They know this. But you have to draw the conclusion, which frankly, I think they're scared to do. We are not living in a democracy, because if we did, the first place where democratic rule would apply is the workplace. And you know why? Because that's where adults spend most of their lives. 5 out of 7 days, all of your adult life until you retire, you go to work. If you believed in democracy, that's the first place it would have been instituted. But instead, we've never had it. So when I hear a politician say, we are going to Iraq or Afghanistan to bring them democracy, I smile to myself. You can't bring what you don't have. We haven't done that in our country, in the place where we spend most of our lives. And let me bring it to a conclusion this way. Imagine with me, just for a minute, that we had democracy at the workplace. Everybody who goes to work in the factory, the office, or the store, one person, one vote. Now let's ask certain questions and see what happens. Here's a question. Should we close the factory here in Wisconsin or in Pennsylvania or in Idaho and move to China? Everybody in favor of losing your job and having it go to China, raise your hand. Deafening silence. You want to stop the loss of jobs? There it is. Let me give you another example. Here's a new technology we could have in our workplace. It'll make the profits go up by 10%. It has an unfortunate side effect. It pollutes the air that everybody breathes here. Oh, the board of directors decides we want the profit because we're the ones who get it. So we're going to have it. And they say to their workers, we're really sorry about the bad air. If it's hard for you, why don't you get a job someplace else? Oh, goodness. Now let's suppose the workers made the decision democratically. On the one hand, they'd weigh the fact that the profits went up. But on the other hand, they'd weigh the fact that they don't want to get sick. They don't want their family and their relatives and their neighbors to get sick. They would weigh the ecological damage in a way that the corporate boards of directors who live in gated communities and breathe clean air anyway never would. So if you want to do something, well, let me give you one last concrete example. In a democratic workplace, the workers would together decide who gets paid how much money. Do you think they would, if it was democratically decided, give the executives at the top $20 million while the average other person can't pay for the cost of sending their kid to college? It would never happen. They might pay the people at the top a bit more, but they're not going to do what capitalism does because they're looking out for themselves and for people like them. And so if you want to do something about the inequality that obsesses this country, democratize the workplace. It's the surest, best way to collapse the inequality back down. And it doesn't rely on a president to do it in a way with laws that can be undone, because it changes the way business is organized. And that is a much more structural, profound way to get at that problem.
No, So now what, to regular people, what you're saying is going to sound like hippie garbage, out there crazy. How do you get it? You don't get a vote when you go to work. You got to do a job when you go to work. You don't get to own it. The guy owns it, who you work for. And that's how the world works. And nobody can even imagine a different system than that. But you actually, there's actually a real easy way to pull this off. In fact, they're pulling it off in all over the world right now. I remember when I was in Boise, Idaho, I used to go to Boise, Idaho once a year to tell jokes and their comments. Comedy club there, and I would go buy food at a food store that was a co-op. And right. So now what you're talking about is not the state taking over the means of production, which is what people usually think about. What you're saying is that workers set up their own co-ops where we can produce goods and services, and we could do it in that kind of situation. And that's happening in places like Spain, Italy. So can you talk a little bit about that?
Absolutely. Yeah, let me underscore the importance of what you said. You know, this is nothing to do with the government. We don't need the government to do this. Private people can do this. And as you point out, it's been going on, and not just in other countries, in the United States too. I'm going to give you a few examples. I'm going to start with the most successful worker co-op, which is what this is that we're talking about, that has been formed over the last half century. Here's the story. In 1956, in a very poor part of Spain, which was at that time a very poor country anyway, but in one of the poorer parts called the Basque area, Basque, in the north of Spain, a Catholic priest named Father Arismendi gave a famous speech, 1956, to his parishioners who were unemployed. He said, look, if we wait for a capitalist to come here and give us jobs, we will all die of old age before it happens. So let's solve this problem by not waiting. Let's solve the problem by becoming our own employers. In other words, let's set up a worker co-op. The name of the town where they did this is Mondragon, M-O-N-D-R-A-G-O-N, Mondragon. So in 1956, with a total of six local Basque workers, Father Arismendi set up a co-op. Fast forward to today, end of the year 2017, the Mondragon Cooperative Corporation includes about 250 active worker co-ops. Altogether, united in this large corporation, they are the seventh largest corporation in Spain. They include over 100,000 workers.
Wow.
In 250 co-ops.
Wow.
Let me give you an idea of what that means. Once a year, all the workers in a co-op, and they produce everything from food to grocery stores to manufacturing stoves and refrigerators, all kinds of things. Once a year in every worker co-op, there's a meeting of all the workers where they assess the managers to determine whether the managers will be retained or fired, whether the managers will get more or less in their way of pay. So let me say it again for Americans to stop and wonder. The managers don't hire the workers in a worker co-op. It's the other way around. Let me give a second example. At other meetings, they typically meet once every 2 weeks or every 4 weeks, they also make decisions about wages. Here is the current rule governing Mondragon. The highest paid worker cannot make more than 8.5 times what the lowest paid worker earns. Here in the United States, for a large corporation, the ratio between what the CEO gets and the lowest paid worker is around 300-1, not 8.5-1. Guess what? In Mondragon, they don't have the inequality of income that we suffer from. Why not? Because the workers would never tolerate it. They would never vote for it. And that's how wages get set in that part of the world. Now, let me give you another example. In Italy, there's a province, a large province of Italy called Emilia-Romagna. In that part of Italy, for historical reasons, fully 40% of the economy in that area is worker co-ops. If you wanted to go to a place where worker co-ops coexist with capitalist enterprises and have been doing so for decades, Emilia-Romagna is the place. The people want those co-ops, they support those co-ops, they shop in those co-ops, and that's why they're sustained there. Now let's get to the United States. Co-ops are forming all over the United States, and co-ops, worker co-ops, are as old as the United States, because many early religions in the United States, both Protestant and Catholic, and others too, believed that when you read the Bible, you ought to read into it or find in it the idea that if we're all equal in the eyes of God, well, then we ought to be all equal in the workplace that God is looking at too. Give you an example. The famous community of the Shakers, a very deeply religious Protestant community, their workplaces were organized as worker co-ops. And those go back to colonial days in the United States. Today, all across the United States, worker co-ops are forming. And your audience, Jimmy, might be entranced when I tell them who is the leader right now in forming worker co-ops. It isn't workers right now. I mean, they're doing it. But the leading force is actually employers who are converting their businesses from top-down capitalist enterprises into worker co-ops. And let me explain to you why, because it'll come as logical as it really is. Imagine Mr. and I have worked with these people personally, so I know the stories. Imagine a Mr. and Mrs. Smith. They started a business in, I don't know, Dubuque, Iowa, many years ago, and they've been quite successful. And over the years, they now have 182 employees, every single one of whom they hired. They know these people, and they have a successful business. The problem is that Mr. and Mrs. Smith have just reached the age of 65. And it turns out that their kids have other plans. They don't want to take over the business. What is Mr. and Mrs. Smith going to do? Well, they have the following options. Number one, they can close business, but they don't want to do that. First of all, it's their life's work. It's a success. Second of all, that would lose all of those 182 people their livelihood. Number three, community depends on the taxes that are generated by that successful enterprise. They don't want to screw their workers or their community. So they don't want to close the business. All right, what's their second option? They could sell it to another business. But the problem is when you sell it to another business, you don't know what they're going to do. They might close the business. They might fire the worker. They don't want to do that either. Well, they could, third option, they could make it into a shareholder company to go public. But then it's the same problem. You don't know. So guess what they're deciding to do? How do you preserve the jobs? How do you preserve the taxes for the community? You sell the business to your own workers. That's how you do it. And they're doing it all over the country, because it's a way to get a better outcome when Mr. and Mrs. Smith retire than any other option they face. And they're doing it everywhere.
So
last point.
So
last
let me ask you very quickly before you move on to the next point. So those workers, do they have a rich uncle? Where do they get the money to buy that business?
Good. Glad you stopped me. Let's go over the options. Where would the workers get the money? First thing you may be surprised to know, since this has been going on, by the way, in various parts of the United States for many years, The lawyers and the accountants who work on that, because you have to change one kind of business into a worker co-op, have developed very good relationships with a variety of local and regional banks in the United States who have lent money to worker co-ops to do it. So there's a track record. You can, if you're doing this, you can come to us at Democracy at Work, and we will hook you up with the lawyers and the accountants and the bankers who will provide. That's number one. Number two, suppose a group of workers living in a community could go to the community using the internet these days to crowdfund. You want to keep this these jobs here? You want to keep these businesses here? Help us. Help us to make this a worker co-op. Here's a third option, and I've done this myself. You go to the local politician, the mayor, the congressperson, the senator. And by the way, I got to tell you, I like this. Let me describe to you how it looks. You come into the office of the big politician, and you say to him, listen, Mr. Mayor, listen, Mr. Senator, there's this factory. It's got 400 people. The employer wants to sell it to the workers. The workers want to buy it. But it's going to be hard because it's difficult. So we need some help from you, Mr. Politician. We need you to get us a tax holiday for a few years so that we don't have to pay taxes, to make it a little easier to get the finances done. And we'd like you to endorse this and give us your blessing. And if you do, Mr. Mayor or Mr. Senator, we will be your greatest boosters in this area. We will tell everyone that you enabled these jobs to be protected and saved. You enabled the community's tax base to be preserved. And then I smile and I move my chair a few steps back and I say to the politician, and if you don't help us, you won't get elected dog catcher around here. And you know something? I never have to finish that sentence. They're politicians, they know exactly where I'm going. And you can bet they help a lot. And now here's the last part, and I think we'll entrance you. Jeremy Corbyn, Labour Party leader in England, has come up with the following plan to build a worker co-op sector in England. He has promised that if he is elected, and right now the polls show that if there's an election in the next 12 months in England, Jeremy Corbyn will be the new prime minister. If he's elected, he has promised that he will pass a law which says that before any existing business can either close or move out of the country or sell itself to another business, they have to give what's called right of first refusal to their own workers to convert the business into a worker co-op. And then, smiling into the TV camera, Mr. Corbyn says, and if all of you are wondering where the workers will get the money, let me explain it to you. If we win the election, the government will lend it to them at a really low interest rate. Let me tell you, the movement beyond capitalism, built around worker co-ops, it's already underway. And as it gathers steam, watch out.
So that's the solution. People who are afraid of socialism, meaning the government taking over the means of production, this is actually from the bottom up. This is people. Exactly. This is right. So this is workers taking control of their economy and then making decisions that benefit their communities instead of decisions that benefit the 1% of people who live in their community, the business owners. Right.
Right. And the way I would summarize it is simple. If you want an economy that works for the people, you've got to put the people in charge of the enterprises. To democratize the enterprise is the only way to make an economy serve everybody rather than the 1% who sit at the top of this pyramid and whose growing wealth is an advertisement to everybody of an economy that isn't working for the average person.
So I really appreciate you being generous with your time like this, and let me know when you have to go. We'll let you go because we could talk to you all day. But there's how How so? Like, people don't know. I used to talk about this in my stand-up act in the late '90s. That once you go to Europe, it kind of changes how you see things. And people don't know that, you know, once you go to get a job, if you're a waitress or whatever, or a waiter or a bus driver or a tax, you get 4 weeks paid vacation a year. In places like France, no matter what, you don't have to go to college. If you got a job, you're going to get 4 weeks or 5 weeks of paid vacation a year. People in America think that's crazy. Like, you're some kind of communist if you think that should be like, as if we can't afford that stuff. And I have to remind people, we're the richest country in the world. We can, of course, we can afford that stuff. But we have a system, as Jack Ma has elucidated for us, we don't spread the money around correctly. We have all the money. You know, you mentioned Piketty earlier. What he has demonstrated is that if you invest money into an economy, in a capitalist economy, your return on investment is going to be greater than the growth of the economy. So what does that mean? That means you're extracting wealth from workers. You're not actually investing in an economy. You're extracting wealth. So that's really what's happening. So how do we get this co-op to catch on in such a massive way? How come people don't know about the system in Europe? How come people don't know about the Spanish system or what's happening in Italy? So why don't people know about this stuff, and how do we make it, how do we bring awareness to it so we can actually make it happen here in America?
Well, you know, the basic reason people don't know is that we've allowed the mechanisms of communication, the mass media, particularly newspapers, radio, television, and so on, to be handled as private capitalist enterprises. So you can't really be surprised that if the means of communication are owned by private capitalist enterprises, they don't spread the word about things that are not good for private capitalist enterprises. For example, a law that requires every employer to give every worker 5 weeks of paid vacation, which has been, by the way, the law in France for decades. Just like the working week in France is 37 hours long, not 40 hours long. Just like in France, just to use that example, they have a national health insurance that covers every French citizen from the day you're born to the day you die. If you have a catastrophic illness, or for that matter, not catastrophic, you're covered. I was a visiting professor at the University of Paris a few years ago. And when you work in France in a university, you also discover something. A, there are no private universities in France. They're all government. You know why? Because they believe that if you had private universities, they will become the universities of rich people, and all the non-rich will be pushed into the public. Something that we should understand here in the United States. They think private education is undemocratic. Anyway, I was a professor and I got a card. And when I got the card, I discovered I was now eligible for the public health service. It was an amazing experience because I got sick. I got strep throat. I went to the doctor. There are no clerks. There are no file cabinets. There are no nothing. Everything is computerized. You hand the doctor a card. He sticks it in the computer. He sees your entire medical history. He prescribes to you whatever it is you need. You go down to the clinic. When I asked, well, you know, how do I pay for this? He smiled. He said, there is no charge for this. You're covered by the National Health. And the reason we can do that is because we don't have an army of secretaries, an army of clerks, an army of people who spend all day fighting with insurance companies to see whether they'll cover you or not. We don't waste money on all that crap. And as a result, the French people, who have a much better health insurance system than we do, spend much less of a share of their national product on health than we do here in the United States. Because we have to pay the prices that go into the profits of private companies. The internet is the way to go. The internet, at least for a while, you can see the encroachment of capitalism in the struggle today over net neutrality. But even before we get to that, you need to have ways of communicating that are not owned and operated by private profit-making capitalist enterprises, because they will block the discussion and the information. When I read yesterday that the Koch brothers are part of a group that just purchased Time magazine, I realized, oh my God, now we're going to see another voice for those people's interests, and those are not interests that will help us get to a fairer and a better economic system.